You're listening to Best Forevers, a podcast for kindred spirits. I'm Alysa Lucas, and I started this podcast because I feel like, and I've always felt like, friends do not always get their due. They don't get their due in general, as friendships are situated behind romantic and family relationships. There are far more songs dedicated to love and romantic relationships than there are ones dedicated to friends. And you know what? There's less research on the topic of friendship as well. And that's important because what we know and what we understand about friendships comes from research, and we need to know more. So today I wanted to share with you some more of my research on friends. And I know that might be scary and alarming when you hear the word research, but I just want to share with you what I found and have a conversation about what it means for friendship and what we can do in the future. I wanted to talk about how I started, how I developed my research program, the early career grant I received from Central Michigan University, and what I think it all means for friends. So yes, friends, you get me today. Alysa. Hi. Just me. No friends joining me unless you count Ferguson, who's sitting behind me like a creeper. No interviews. You get me talking about the research that means so much to me and fills in a portion of the person I am and the work I do as a professor. I hope you like it. As one warning, as you'll soon discover, my research focuses on sexual communication. So I wanted to give two sort of warnings, if you will. One, on the scale of explicitness from 0 to 10, this is probably going to be about like a 2 or 1, maybe even less. So if you're like, woohoo, sex, I'm not going to get that much into it. I'm not a doctor like that. I'm an information doctor. Okay. The second warning is that towards the end, when I start wrapping things together, I make points about the Me Too campaign, Title IX, consent, and so on. It's a general and vague discussion, but I still thought it was important that listeners knew that was coming. So let's get started. How did I get started, right? Y'all know about that 55-page paper I wrote for my undergraduate interpersonal communication class. I talked about it in episode 11, What Should Be Taboo, Bad Poetry or Jealousy in Friendship? And hopefully you answer, jealousy should not be taboo. It's bad poetry. But yes, folks, I thought I was amazing at poetry in 2000. So you'll definitely want to listen back to that one because I actually share some of that poetry with you. And you know what? Patreon listeners, I'll read some more of my poems and put it on Patreon as an extra this week. So enjoy, okay? But my curiosity for friends and what we could do about it more formally in terms of conducting research to understand friendship started when I was in classes at Michigan State University. I was a communication major, completely immersed in classes related to my interests of communication and relationships, and even taking a class focusing on research methods where you learn about how to critique and conduct research. It was one of my favorite classes. Basically, I was a nerd. So when I wrote that novel of a paper, I think my call to action was, let's focus on the nuances of friendship, right? That was my battle cry. Like, we need to know more about friendship. And I have 55 pages of reasons why we should. Now, this specific paper in class with Dr. Kelly Morrison led me to my thesis, which I talked about in that episode I just mentioned. That thesis focused on jealousy and female friendships, but my research actually doesn't entirely focus on jealousy. It was another class at Michigan State that got me moving into full research mode. I took communication theory with Dr. Sandy Smith, who I absolutely adore, and she suggested I write a paper with a different topic than the one I was working on with Kelly. So, folks, I took a hard left, and I wrote a paper about, are you all sitting down? Get this, romantic partners. What? Alysa, what are you doing? Right? Yes, I focused on romantic partners. In the paper, I was interested in the conversations romantic partners have that includes sharing sexual history information with each other. And here's the thing. A lot of romantic partners talk about sex when? After they have sex. And a lot of times, those conversations don't necessarily focus on sexual history. And you might be asking why, or you're probably going, I know the answers to this question. Think about it. How often do we talk about our past relationships and our new or current relationships? So just recently, I saw a Friends episode where Monica's boyfriend, Richard, played by the amazing Tom Selleck with that glorious mustache. He wanted to know how many sexual partners she's had. He's had two, his ex-wife and Monica. So obviously he's sitting pretty going, I told you mine, now you tell me yours. And Monica sort of evades the question, she jokes and so on. And they do end up having a little bit more of a discussion about it. And it's more of an open and understanding conversation. But somehow Ross and Rachel hear about this, and that's when they're dating. I think it was before the break. Although, I don't think, were they on a break? You let me know. Email me. Okay, or post on social media. At Best Forever's Pod. But Ross wants to know how many partners Rachel has had, and he gets upset when she talks about it. So it makes perfect sense that people would want to avoid conflicts or avoid upsetting their partners with details that might not be helpful to their current relationship. However, what about the discussions that do matter? Like, have you been tested for HIV? Do you have a sexually transmitted infection? Do you have and or use condoms? Are you on birth control? Do you want to get pregnant? I mean, shouldn't these be the questions and conversations that romantic or even sexual partners should be having? You don't even have to be in a relationship to have sex. And so should this be a discussion with sexual partners as well? I know you're probably thinking, Alysa, where is the friendship? But it's not there. You can look for it, search for it. This paper was strictly about romantic partners. And I finished my master's degree with my thesis focusing on jealousy and friendships. But this paper does come back when I traveled to Penn State for my PhD. My advisor, Dr. Walida Fifi, who I'm sure I've talked about a couple times, at least in the teacher episode, and maybe in the episode about jealousy research. He read a proposal I wrote about jealousy and friendship and was basically like, and this is not a direct quote, but was like, this topic is dead. Jealousy is dead, right? How does studying this topic help people? And I was like, it totally matters because friendship matters. But he has a good point, right? And this was something I also learned at MSU, and that is to ask the question, so what? What does your research matter? Why does it matter? So what about it? Tell me why it should be important. Tell me why people should care. How do your interest in research, whether it be jealousy and friendship or sexual communication, how does that translate into research that can help people? Now, when I talk about research, I just want to break it down because sometimes I think people don't know what that means. And if you do, you know, maybe go ahead, hit that ahead button maybe twice, right? But basically what I mean is that I've read peer-reviewed journal articles, right, about the topics I'm interested in. And you might know those from work or from when you were in college, and maybe you enjoy reading those. And for some of you, maybe it haunts you at night. And for some of you, you might be like, I've never even seen a peer-reviewed research article. Peer-reviewed just means that it's read by people who study similar things and have expertise in that area. So after reading those articles, I create an argument that leads to either a research question if I'm not sure what might happen, or I pose a hypothesis that I can test if the research supports it, like the research leads to this hypothesis. Like, you know, maybe research would say that women's friendships are more face-to-face than men's friendships are. Men's friendships are more side-to-side. I talked about that in episode 4, Male Friendship with a Capital F, with my great friend, Dr. Jonathan Bowman. That's a great episode. You want to go back and re-listen or have a listen if you haven't for the first time. But research might say that, so I can propose a hypothesis for that. But if I'm not sure, I have to ask a question, right? So then what I do is I conduct a study. Maybe I do interviews with people when I have a research question, or maybe I have people fill out surveys to test my hypothesis. There's a bunch of research analyses that are happening, and I'm making these hand gestures like it reminds me of Wayne's World. You can go past that movie montage, past the research analyses, and really gets at what do we find? What did the answer to the question come to be? Did the hypothesis, was it supported or not supported? So that's what I mean by research. And so when people say they've done research, in some cases, that might be what they mean. So one of the things with research is thinking that there might be some problem going on, like maybe a problem in friendships, like jealousy, and I want to solve that problem by looking at research that already exists, seeing if I can propose a research question or test a hypothesis, conduct a study with survey. There's so many different ways you can do studies depending on the questions you're asking. I often do surveys, and I'm sure many of you filled those out. Circle number, strongly agree, written a response, open-ended. And then maybe at the end, there is some support that might help us move forward and ask a different question, do a different research study, or we might be able to come up with recommendations for what could be done. So going back to Penn State, Wally challenged me. He said, come up with a topic that is more likely to help more people. So when I'm going to do my research, as I just talked about, I need to think about the problems that matter to me. And obviously, I keep coming back to friendship. That's always my go-to. I'm concerned about that. I'm concerned what's going on in friendship. And so I really wanted to find a problem that I thought plagued friendships. Thus, I went back to some of the things that I did at Michigan State. And I came back to the sexual history paper, and I wondered, if romantic partners don't really talk about these topics, I bet these individuals are talking about it with their friends. And considering the CDC's rate for sexually transmitted infections and unintended pregnancies, it seems like knowing who people talk about sex with may help us understand the issues around sex. So if they talk about sex with their friends, we might be able to understand friendship more, we might be able to understand sexual communication more, and things related to sex. And if you're interested, the last time I checked, the CDC's rates for sexually transmitted infections were that there were 21 million new cases a year, and over half of those are with young people. Also, with unintended pregnancies, about 50% of unintended pregnancies fall in the age group of 18 to 24. So certainly there's the problem, right? That's a lot of sexually transmitted infections each year, and that could be a lot of unintended pregnancies. So if we understand the choices people are making, then we can maybe better understand that problem and how to solve it. But even more, what I'm posing is that we talk to friends about sex, and so if we understand those conversations among friends, then maybe we can start to get at how we can help people make choices, give their friends social support, so on and so forth, that might impact their decisions. But as I mentioned before, not as much research exists related to friendship. Oh, sure, there is research that exists, and one of the most prolific researchers I've mentioned a lot on this podcast is Bill Rollins. Love him. But as you can imagine, the research about friendship is less frequent than that which focuses on romantic relationship. So research is by far focusing on romantic relationships, and the pool of studies focusing on friendship, no matter the topic, is pretty small. As I began my research, I found that even less research focuses on sex talk among friends. Most studies, primarily in psychology, would simply ask participants, do you talk to a peer or a friend about sex, yes or no? So you have to pick a box. And here's the thing. Most things when you pick a box are much more nuanced than the two boxes provided, right? So when you think about communication, the meaning of communication, relationships, the meaning of relationships, building relationships, maintaining relationships, things are much more complicated and nuanced than a yes or no question. So I started to conduct research to determine that that was something young people did, that young people, they talk about sex. Now, those peer-reviewed journal articles I talked about, early work by Spanier talked about friends as sources of sexual information. And then there were a couple people, Harold and Way and Johnson and Aries, that talked about the primary topics that friends discuss. And then a little later, Lefkowitz and her colleagues started looking at quality conversations of best friends in emerging adulthood. Emerging adulthood is a life period that exists, according to researcher Arnett, that covers young people who are not under 18, but who are not yet married or have children. So it's like a new life period between young adulthood and adulthood, hence emerging adulthood. And the reason why this exists is because we delay marriage. We're getting married later, therefore we're having kids later. People might be extending college, job seeking, whatever the case might be. So when people are focusing on other things other than what we might consider adulthood, like having family and getting married and so on and so forth, having those responsibilities and obligations, what happens is that our friends are more at the forefront, that we have much more freedom to explore. And I think it's the case, and I'll put all of my sources for this episode in my show notes. I'm not sure on the source for this, so if anyone is aware of this, please let me know. But it's my understanding that our identity is not fully developed until we're 25. So if you think about emerging adulthood, it's like identity exploration and figuring out who you are and, you know, auditioning relationships and sexual exploration, figuring out who you are, your sexuality, so on and so forth, before you then get married and have kids and move into adulthood. So I wanted to know if emerging adulthoods, who are typically aged 18 to 25, but it could go up to 28, and those at risk for STIs and unintended pregnancies, talked about sex. So over several research studies, I found out a lot more nuanced information about communication among friends. But again, I don't want to get too technical. I did want to define a few things. I want to build it up for you. So that's why I mentioned some researchers. I want to give credit where credit is due. And then the rest of the sources will be in my show notes. But I also wanted to define a few things like emerging adulthood. So in terms of what I found, I just want to break it down and then we'll talk about it a little bit more. We'll unpack it. So this is what I found over several studies. College-age emerging adults do talk about sex. My early research and since then has indicated that nearly 90% or more of my participants across several studies across hundreds of people talked about sex with the same-sex friend. So if they identified as female, they were referring to a female friend, and if they identified as male, they were talking to a male friend. And they did so occasionally to frequently. On average, they were talking about approximately 11 different topics related to sex. And those topics were most frequently defined as fun. So I'm sure you're going, Alysa, is this where you get to the 2 point on the explicit scale? And the answer is yes. Okay. So fun sex talk were sexual behaviors. So when they lost their virginity, how many times they did it, what positions they did, what they liked, what they didn't like, things like that. So the different behaviors they had. They talked about relationships, sexual sensations, so what it felt like. Then they talked about sexual health at the very bottom. And one of the things that I found out later, and we'll talk about more, is whether or not to have sex. And so sexual health was primarily talked about with women, and they were mainly talking about birth control. So if you do go, hey, were they talking about anything related to health? Birth control was the number one topic. They also maybe mentioned condoms, AIDS, STDs, some warnings related to sex, and doctor visits. But this is a much lower percentage than those fun topics that I discussed. And a lot of times what I found in the sexual health information is that the information they discussed was false. And I referred to this in episode 24, The Chick to Her Duck, where I talk with Tara about our research and our friendship. And one of the things that I found is, you know, male participants, for example, would talk about using more than one condom and telling their friend to double bag it. And as we say, double bagging means friction, and that means the condom's going to rip. So don't do that, right? So fun stuff is more likely to be discussed, sexual health talk less likely, and then sometimes it's not accurate. But here's the thing. Participants were highly satisfied and happy with the conversations they were having with their friends, especially when their friends showed them interest and shared a similar story. But they were not happy when their friends avoided the conversation or communicated how different they were. So, oh, I would never do anything like that. Well, me and my boyfriend don't talk about that, or you know, whatever the case is, like something that would indicate we are very different from each other. And that is not something that is very satisfying for friends when they're talking about something perhaps they consider to be fun, like they want to have fun. So maybe it's like, hey, Debbie Downer, you know, why don't you bring it up a notch, you know? Or that it could be that it's a vulnerable topic and then expressing disinterest or disgust can shut people down. But here's the thing. Those were several studies. That was probably my entire PhD besides my dissertation, cut down to about 2 minutes. But there's still more to know. And so that's when I did my dissertation. And for those of you who are not familiar with academics, the dissertation is like the key to the PhD lock, that you become a doctorate, a doctor. I became Dr. Lucas once I finished my dissertation and defended it, and my committee of faculty members approved it. So my dissertation was developed out of these findings, and I wanted to look at the role of friendship support and anticipated regret in the sexual decision-making process of college students. So anticipated regret isn't something that we hear every single day, so I just want to explain that really quick. This is when you consider the negative feelings you might experience after you make a decision. So for example, I got a tattoo when I was in Paris on my trip with Tara, and I thought a lot about what would happen after, how I would feel. Would I regret getting a tattoo while traveling because I have to clean it and the potential for infection? Even though I'm 40, what would my parents think? Would I like it? Is it in the right spot? What's the best spot to get? What should I get? Or like the tattoo meme that I'm sure everyone's seen is, would I have regrets? Right? I had some of these discussions with Tara, so I was thinking that maybe friends might anticipate regret during chats about sex, right? that they might go to their friends and be like, let's anticipate regret together. You can socially support me. So let's see what this means. So first, if friends like fun conversations that are mirrored by their friends, I wanted to look more into the role of social support. And Tara and I discussed this in the Chick to Her doc. So if you want a refresher, or you want to go back and listen to that, or you haven't had a chance, that's the episode where we discuss our friendship and our research on sexual stressors as it relates to communication competence and a whole lot of other things. But social support is viewed as a function of friendship, right? It's something that we do, that a friend is supportive. But it can be difficult to communicate support when you're not sure what the receiver's needs are. So I thought perhaps social support could potentially be problematic. Thus, I wanted to explore this question. If friends are positive and provide social support during sex talks, could they encourage their friend to participate in risky behavior if they do anticipate regretting the decision? So here's what I learned. Again, let's break down 2 years of work and 300 pages into 2 minutes. But I think that's the point, right? That's one of the reasons why I wanted a podcast, is that I wanted to share research with you in a way that was enjoyable and accessible and not getting into on page 203, right? So at least 89% of the participants indicated chatting with their friend for assistance in sexual decision-making on at least one occasion, with over 60% doing so more frequently. Here is something really interesting, though. On the survey, I asked participants, do you seek out your friends for sexual decisions? And then if so, like how frequently? And then what did you talk about? Like what decisions, right? What decisions did you discuss with your friend? And people would say, no, I make my own decisions. I don't talk to my friend. And then they would spend the rest of the page talking about all the decisions that their friend talked to them about. And I found that to be fascinating, that there is maybe a human need to be like, no, I got this. I don't need any help. But then now that you know that, let me tell you all the ways that my friend helped me. Really fascinating stuff. In that study, and it was a 3-part study, which I will not bore you with all those details, but if you do want more information, you know, you can email me and I'll send that to you. The most common behavioral decision that friends made with the help of other friends, we labeled, and I'm talking about me and my advisor, Dr. John Nussbaum, as whether or not to. Whether or not to decisions included participants asking friends for assistance with determining whether or not they should hook up with someone, have a one-night stand, have sex with an ex, have sex for the first time in a relationship, cheat on a partner, lose virginity. So whether or not to then insert any sexual behavior. The ones I just listed, though, were the most commonly reported. And the study actually focused on the hooking up because that was the most commonly one reported across all studies for both men and women. During these conversations about sexual decisions, they said that their friends provided them a lot of support. And there were a couple different types of support that were most common. Participants noted that friends frequently provided ego support, which focuses on making their friend feel good about themselves, their sex-related problem, or their sexual decision. Friends also provided informational support, and this is where they would give advice on whether or not to participate. So they would say, well, when I did this, or this is what I've heard, or, you know, just giving some type of tip or feedback, if you will. And then finally, the other popular reported type of support was emotional support, and that was being there when needed. So listening, letting them vent, whatever the case was. But overall, ego support was preferred. And what I did find in that study was that friend support was a strong predictor in intentions to seek friends' advice in the future and intentions to participate in sexual behavior. So I actually found that receiving the support for a friend meant that they were going to see their friend again. So next time I have a sexual decision, I'm searching out my friend, right? And that also that predicted whether or not they participated in a hookup at a party. Now, this is what you call programmer research. This is several studies building off one another, and my work is focused on potential problematic events in friendship, which translate into how friends talking about sex may impact decisions about sex. I learned a lot about friends talking about sex through all this research I conducted while I was at Penn State University and even when I was at Mansfield University of Pennsylvania. But there is so much more to confirm and explore. In the future, I will report research findings and episodes with specific topic focus like I have before, right? Where I've interviewed people or I give just a little bit of information, or you can guarantee that Tara and I will be back on talking about the research we're up to, and I will update you on the research I'm about to talk to you about now. Because I wanted to share with you the findings from my work that I've been doing at Central Michigan University. I received an early career grant from Central Michigan University entitled Emerging Adults, the Role of Friends in Sexual Decision-Making. And I would just like to stop here and say thank you to Central Michigan for providing me the opportunity to explore all these things that I've been studying since I basically came out of the womb. Now, I wasn't like out of the womb, like, do friends talk about sex? But I was interested in friendship, and that developed over the years. And then I wrote that 55-page paper, and a thesis, and then that one romantic partner paper, and then Wally challenged me, and I did all these studies and these building blocks to learn more and more about this area of research that is mine. It's a very specific area that I study, and there are people out there who study it, but not everyone. That's a program of research where I'm building upon the questions I've asked and the findings that I've received or found, and then moving forward with more questions. And so that's what I wanted to do with the grant. The purpose of the grant was to continue exploring all of the things that I've found so far. I had questions about how friendships developed into sexual conversations. Like, how did that happen? Is it just like, hey, pass the salt, by the way, sex, right? How does that happen? What happens during the sexual decision-making process? So in my dissertation, friends said that they were there during sexual decision-making, but how were they there? When were they there? What are the types and timing of social support that leads to decision options and decision aftermath feelings? So looking at the whole process of it, right, and trying to maybe get some timing out. So I conducted two longitudinal studies. First, I looked at the question of developing those sexual conversations with first-year students during their first fall semester at Central Michigan University. They completed surveys four times over the course of the semester. I found that by the time the first survey was completed, that 95.9% of the participants had already discussed sex with their new friends. So much for developing over the course of the friendship. Sex talk was happening right away. Now, the topic, seriousness, and so on, that might all change, but sex appears to be the topic on the table when you get to know someone. And I was like, what? I feel like that wasn't the first thing I talk about when I was in college, but it was probably something that was developed into. So I was really interested with this finding. And so through the grant, I was able to conduct a follow-up study to explore exactly what was going on. The participants confirmed that they were already talking about sex at the start of things. Some people were talking about sex with their roommates over social media before they even set a foot on campus. Other people would get to know their roommates or new friends through, well, let's go to a coffee shop and we just talked about everything. But within the first couple of weeks, they were already talking about it. And in the follow-up study, they said that it was for a number of reasons. Comparison, so it's like checking people out, like, where do you stand compared to other people? That it's a level of comfort to be able to talk about these things with other people. They wanted to make connections with new friends, that it's fun to talk about. That seems familiar. They wanted to get help and advice, much like informational support that we talked about. And they talked about one of the reasons being status or bragging. So letting people know that maybe you are a big fish in a small pond and you're ready to take on this pond. I'm not entirely sure, but that was something they noted. That definitely needs to be explored more in terms of bragging, but it certainly appears that students may discuss these topics as a way to develop new friendships and to negotiate their identity in college, how they might fit in with other people. And a lot of these conversations were happening at parties, returning from weekends at home when they might have seen their boyfriend or girlfriend, when they were meeting new people, and at campus programs. So they're like, hey. So I don't know, they get together for something that maybe was required for campus, and then they would talk about sex there. And as you might guess, most of those conversations were about fun topics and not serious ones. The second longitudinal study I conducted was across a fall semester as well, but included students of all ages. This study is still under continued analyses, but open-ended responses showed a range of sexual stressors and choices students are making regarding their sexual health and sexuality, and they were clear that their friends were there during different periods of the process. So I'm still doing the number analysis, if you will, but I have some of their open-ended writing, some of those findings, some themes from that, and that's what we found so far. So stay tuned for more episodes dedicated to this research and related topics, because as things are published or as things are found out, I would like to share that with you because I think it's relevant to this podcast of friendship, but also I think, as noted before, that sexual communication, sexual health, these are all important topics that are significant to our daily lives, to our relational lives, and I think it's important for people to know. So what does this all mean, though? Like, let's bring it together. Now, I don't think I can nicely answer that one question here about all we know about friends talking about sex, because there's so much more to know. And that's what I'll continue to do. However, I have some overarching ideas and questions that I think are critical. So here we go. Friends do talk about sex, so check that off. It is a phenomenon that exists. Maybe not all friends talk about sex. Maybe not all discuss fun topics like sexual positions, but it is a phenomenon that exists, and we should want to know more for a number of reasons, which I'll discuss throughout this entire wrap-up. But one that I can think of right now is wanting to know the topics people discuss and don't discuss. So, for example, think about this. If college students talk about fun stuff, or whether or not to have sex with someone, how can those conversations talk about protection, consent, and safety? Is there a way to get those topics into conversations that friends are having so that they're having those conversations and it's not just something that's just never discussed, right? If friends don't discuss sex, then we need to know why not. Is it discussed with a doctor, with a partner? And I mean, research doesn't suggest romantic partners talk about sex, but research by Segrin and Powell suggests that people who talk to their parents and their friends about sex are more likely to talk to their romantic partners about sex. So should we encourage open sex talk with friends because it's going to produce more open sex conversations elsewhere? Friends support each other, and that's critical. So that's something else I think is important here, is that we do see social support. But the question becomes, are they good at it? Do we just want people to mirror us and share the same kind of stories we share? Do we just want similarity and familiarity? If so, that doesn't necessarily mean the result is effective social support. If someone is constantly providing ego support, for example, because they want to make their friend feel good, and friendships are generally based on positivity, then is it possible they might encourage potential regrets, right? Maybe our friends encourage us to participate in behaviors that might not be so good for us because it's like positivity all the time, right? Like negativity is like, oh, awkward, uncomfortable. And then you add in sex and it's like super awkward. So let's keep it all light and fun and airy and, you know, enjoyable. I also wonder how we are developing friendships now. Is sex talk critical to getting to know someone? Like, I was completely surprised by the finding of my first longitudinal study, and that's exactly why I wanted to explore more. Is it critical to get to know someone? What level of information is shared? Is it simply, oh, are you a virgin or not? Or is it more? What if someone doesn't have a lot of experience or doesn't want to discuss this with someone they just met? Does that mean that developing friendships for them could be a lot more difficult? And I know you're going, if that person is going to be a jerk to them because they're a virgin, then they don't want to be friends with them anyway, and they're probably going to find their people at some point. But that doesn't mean being ignored or rejected for sexual experience or lack of sexual experience at the start of college feels good, right? So initial results suggest that sex talk is a way to get acclimated to one's new culture and potentially their identity and developing that identity. This is who I am and this is how I fit in here. And I think that really leads into some conversations that are happening now across the nation. And we should be having more of these discussions and we should be doing more research and we should understand the topic more and we should be doing more to solve the problem. But so think about it. There is the discussion of Title IX across campuses, the Me Too campaign. It seems critical to know if sex talk leads people to getting help for any sexual stressors they're experiencing. Now, sexual stressors can be anything from being confused about their sexuality or lack of sex, so they want to be having sex, or feeling like their partner won't use contraceptives when they want to, or even an attempted sexual assault or a completed sexual assault. There's a wide range of sexual stressors. But when they're experiencing them, do they get help? Do their friends help them? Do they go to their friends for help? Is that why we only see fun topics, because they don't want to talk to their friends about it? Or do they think that their friends will be way overwhelmed by what they have to say? But then I also wonder, are they seeing counselors on campus? And are there enough counselors in which to see them? Do they know what resources are available to them? On CMU's campus, we have this amazing program called SAPA, Sexual Regression Peer Advocates. And let me tell you a little bit about it. It is a peer advocate program, and students on campus go through hours and hours and hours and hours and hours of training. And then what they do is they go into classrooms and they do programs there. I have them come into my gender communication class to talk about language. I have them come in to talk about stalking and sexual assault. They do 24/7 chats online. They do 24/7 calls. They do all sorts of advocacy and education. And through the SAPA program, what has come from it is the No Zebras campaign. So every student who comes into Central's campus is required to attend this program that looks at not being a bystander. When you see things going on with something that seems funny with alcohol, with someone, you know, setting someone up to separate them from their friends or to get them alone, what do you do? And this program is amazing. The SAPA advocates are outstanding, and they do a lot of great work for CMU. And it's my understanding that this program is a model across the nation. So kudos to Steve Thompson, who created it, and for those students and staff who continue it every day, because they do the Lord's work, if you know what I mean. Okay. But could information about sex talk among friends add something significant to SAPA or the programs or any programs on campuses? I think it's critical that colleges and universities make resources available and understand the role of sex, sex talk, relationships, sex culture, alcohol, consent, and all the best ways to address the students who are experiencing these, which is probably everyone living on their campuses, off their campuses, or visiting their campuses. And I wonder if research can help universities make sure that their resources are available, or maybe there's a way to do a program where it encourages friends in appropriate communication, or a script that can help them help their friends get to resources or get to a counselor or get to a SAPA advocate. And if you're a parent, is it helpful to know what your children talk about with who and when? If you're sending a child off to college, what do you think their first weeks will look like in terms of making friends, getting acclimated to the campus's unique culture, but also the college culture, and exploring life and themselves and everyone around them as the college environment allows, right? I think this is something where you're like, this sounds like something college students need to know about. I think campuses need to know about it. I think parents need to know about it. But here's the thing. I focused on college age emerging adults. What about those who don't attend college? Not all emerging adults are in college. Now, college provides an environment that is ripe for developing friendships, right? Ripe for finding partners, parties, alcohol, hooking up. There's lots of things that college provides that sort of makes it an environment where these things are happening. But what is it like for individuals who are not in college? Even more, what do adults talk about? Is it simply a topic for partners and everyone else, and it's just not their business? Or did the topics change? Do we start talking about infertility issues, intimacy, erectile dysfunction, lack of sex, or other pertinent sexual issues? I think it would be important to address sex talk across the lifespan and friendships and how social support plays a role. And I guess, really, to be truly honest, if friends play a role, right? I talked about friendship sex talk, but does it happen? We need to know more about it. And folks, I didn't even bring up all the ways in which friends talk about sex via text, like peaches and eggplants and other venues. There's so much work to be done. These are just some of the questions I have, some of the thoughts I have. I have so many more, but I didn't want to overload you. There's always a next episode, right? But there's so much to do. I think it's important. It impacts a wide range of people, and there are questions to explore for, you know, the rest of my life. So consider me busy for the foreseeable future. Like, okay, bye. I'm going to do research. But I'm really interested in what you think. Please send me questions, feedback, and any stories related to sex talk and friendships to bestforeverspod@gmail.com. But also, I understand, folks, that this topic calls for some privacy. So I've also posted a related survey on bestforeverspod.com nbsp/surveys so that your identity can be protected. Any stories or questions will be shared on a future episode of the podcast. And I'm also collecting all sorts of stories of friendship. So please email me or check out the surveys on the webpage to see if there's a topic that you would like to share with me. Remember, I'm not nosy, but I love to geek out over friendship. So send me all your stories this way. And folks, if you can email me by the 22nd, or there's a survey on the webpage, in two episodes, I will be doing pet friendships. So talking about how pets are our best friends. And so if you have stories, photos, whatever, I need them by Sunday, July 22nd, so I can finish up my episode and get it all together for my editor. But I would love, 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 love to hear all of your stories and see all the pictures of your cute pups, cats, horses, snakes, I mean, whatever. If you like what you have in your ear holes, there's a few things you can do. I'd love to have you follow Best Forevers on social media. You can find the podcast on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at Best Forevers Pod, and I'm at Dr. Alysa Lucas on Twitter. Social media is a great way to follow the podcast for updates and get involved with discussions and other items related to friendship. I look forward to us connecting. If you care about friendship like I do and want to support Best Forevers, you might consider supporting the movement to love on our friends more on patreon.com/bestforeverspod. There's lots of cool perks and goals. Check it out. I would love to call you my friends with benefits. So thanks to all my lovely patrons. I just ordered new mic stands, and when they get here, I will be sending you photos, but I greatly appreciate it. And then moving on to the next goal, and there's lots of contests, so come join me and Best Forevers on Patreon. Finally, thanks for listening to Best Forevers. I appreciate every single listen, like, follow, post, and retweet. Please subscribe, rate, and review Best Forevers. It really is very helpful to the podcast and being sure that other people are finding my podcast and so they can hear all about friendship. And certainly, it just warms my friendship, love, and heart to know that you care about Best Forevers too. This week's promos features academic folks like myself. So check out What's Her Name with Katie and Olivia, who tell us all about the woman we've never heard of. And The Vocal Fries with Carrie and Megan, who are chipping away at linguistic discrimination one episode at a time. Both of these podcasts are informative, rooted in research, but completely accessible to you non-academic folks who are like, what's a peer-reviewed journal article? Or even if you know what those things are, highly enjoyable. So check them out and then come back to Best Forevers next week when I have Carrie and Megan on to talk more about their podcast and their friendship. Until then, think about the importance and necessity of talking about sex with our friends. Because without our friends, who would we be?
Hi, everyone. I'm Katie Nelson.
And I'm Olivia Mickle.
We're two academic sisters. And we host a podcast called What's Her Name? What's Her Name podcast tells you the stories of fascinating women that you've never heard of. We're unearthing the histories of really interesting women that have slipped through the cracks of our collective history. We add era-appropriate music. We interview really fascinating experts, everyone from professors to authors to the manager of a brothel museum. We cover it all. So give it a listen. What'sHerNamePodcast.com.
We're the Vocal Fries. I'm Carrie.
And I'm Megan.
And we have a podcast about linguistic discrimination.
We talk about language, not being a jerk, not judging people for the way that they speak, and we try to have a good time.
We talk about things like vocal fry, swearing, Southern American English, and prescriptive grammar.
You can find us on iTunes or your favorite podcast app.